Tonight, as you all know, we're going to have a presentation by Rob and Philpot, and Wuyi Jacobs is going to be the moderator. Unfortunately, Phil Taylor had to cancel tonight, but he has said that he'll come again another time in the near future and present to us as well. This is the third of three kind of unofficial discussions on Rwanda and Congo at the Brecht Forum in the last few weeks since September. We didn't purposely intend to have a series on Central Africa, but events and what's going on have sort of made this all the more urgent and all the more giving us a sense that we needed to bring people together and discuss these issues. And we intend actually to have a more official series on Africa and what's going on that will include topics like Sudan as well as Congo and Rwanda starting in January. So I hope that you'll all leave your names and addresses if you haven't already before you leave tonight, and so we can get in touch with you and let you know about those upcoming events eventually. But I thank you all for coming, and I hope you are edified by the presentation. So I'm going to give it to Wuyi,
and Wuyi will give it to Robin.
Thank you very much, Russell. I welcome you all today to today's event. I am honored to be amongst you. My name is Wuyi Jacobs. I am a host of AfroBeat Radio, which is a radio program on WBAI 99.5 FM, and also publishing at AfroBeatRadio.net and AfroBeatJournal.org. So please do check that out when you have some time. Today's program was supposed to bring together two very good speakers, people who have done a lot of work on Africa, and unfortunately one of them is not here, but Robin Philpot is here with us today, and we are going to be talking on the matter of colonialism, sometimes referred to as neocolonialism, but specifically we're talking about imperialism as it affects the people of Rwanda in Africa. The theme of our conversation is truth about Rwanda and the Congo. So, but before we go any further, I'd like to introduce our guest. Robin Philpot has been described as a Quebec journalist, and sometimes he's also called a Montreal journalist. I wonder why. Maybe he would explain to us. But many of you will know that Quebec is the region in which Montreal is the city. So he lived in Africa in the 70s and taught English and history in Burkina Faso from 1972 to 1974. Robin is also the author of the book 1994, Colonialism Dies Hard. The original version of that book is, I'm going to leave the title of the book for him to say in French. I tried practicing it, but it didn't come out quite well. The book was widely read in Canada, as well as in Africa and in Asia. So we are lucky to have him with us today. Welcome, Robin.
Thank you.
There's a quote that Robin is going to be talking about in his talk to us this evening. The quote was made by the former UN, was said by the former UN Secretary General Boutros-Ghali, and he said, "The Rwandan genocide was 100% American responsibility." When I read that, I had to ask myself the question, what does that mean? Okay, and as a person of African descent, somebody who is from the continent of Africa, I was very surprised at many of the things that have been coming out, you know, in about Rwanda. The idea of a reverse genocide, for instance, that you know, was completely buried in the media, you know, that most of us did not know anything about for the first decade after the event. But I'm going to hand you over to Robin. I think he will do better justice than I will. Thank you very much, and please welcome Robin Philpot.
Thank you, Wuyi. When he introduced himself, he said "we," and I thought, oh, he's speaking to me in French. So, Boutros Ghali was ousted from the UN in 1996 by the Clinton administration, but I'll get back to that. And first of all, I'd like to thank the Brecht Forum for inviting me, and particularly Fred Jerome, my friend, who for suggesting it, and Russell Dale for organizing, and anybody else who's participated in it. The title we chose was Rwanda 1994, Colonialism Dies Hard. And I just want to say Phil Taylor apologizes for not being here. He does a radio program, and he's got a website called the Taylor Report, taylorreport.com. I invite you to go there. There is a lot of material about Rwanda, a lot of good interviews, and the English version of this book, which is Ça ne s'est pas passé comme ça à Kigali, is on that website. We're going to bring out a hard copy probably next year. I personally like this title, the French title, Ça ne s'est pas passé comme ça à Kigali. If I had to translate it accurately, it would literally, it would say, that's not what happened in Kigali, or that's not what happened in Rwanda. But anyway, so well, I propose to speak to you about 30 minutes, maybe 40 minutes, and then we can have an exchange. I think that's probably the best way to proceed. There was, about a month ago, a flurry here in New York around the UN about a report put out on October 1st, and there were leaked versions of this report that following a mapping exercise on massacres that had been occurring in the Congo between 1993 and 2003. Now, this report, it was a flurry of activity, and now it seems everything seems to have calmed down. That report revealed cases of mass killings, of massacres, but then everybody decided to start debating about the use of the word genocide. Can we use this word or can we not use this word? I actually think that it is the example that instead of discussing the content of the report, mass killings documented with witnesses, mass killings going over with systematic ways that are being done, and everybody is sitting discussing whether we should call it this or we should call it that. The fact is that these killings were going on, and systematically, and if anybody, and as I hope to prove to you, this pattern existed since October 1st, 1990, exactly 20 years before that report came out. I would say that fortunately, there are intellectuals who are struggling with this issue. And there was recently a book came out entitled The Politics of Genocide, written by Ed Herman and David Peterson, with a preface by Noam Chomsky. This is a major contribution to the debate. In it, they, for instance, say the vulgar politicization of the concept of genocide is a product of the fading of the Cold War. And they recommend that it be expunged from our vocabulary because it is not, it is used according to the interests of big powers. And they have a double standard in how they use it. All the leading experts on genocide, supposed leading experts, have carefully excluded any reference to U.S. attacks on Vietnam, on any of the countries in what was formerly known as Indochina, excluded references to Iraq, yet they will immediately start naming genocide when it's something being done by their enemy. other words, the word is being used, it tells you more about the interests at play than about the actual fact. And this debate around this report was really disgusting. It shows that we're actually hardened to the fact that there are mass killings going on, because we decide we're going to sit and talk about the use of a word or not. Personally, I think it should not be used. It does not help us to understand what happened. It does not help us to prevent such events from recurring. Now, one of the reasons, of course, that truth does not, we have a hard time getting to the truth on what happened in Rwanda, is that the current government, led by Paul Kagame, has two paid or voluntary advisors, William Clinton and Tony Blair. Now, these people have power, and they can bring a lot to bear to support the current government. They also have an interest in maintaining an official story, because what happened in 94 and before and after was was while Bill Clinton was in power, and then Tony Blair came to power shortly thereafter. Tony Blair in England became one of the most powerful countries operating in Rwanda, whereas before 94 they didn't even have a consulate. And now the embassy of England, the British embassy, is the biggest embassy in Kigali. In other words, there's a change of who has power in that area. Now, there are two reactions to that report. One is they were revenge killings, which is a terrible idea, revenge killings. The other was that here was a good guy, he was our guy, he was the guy we defended, who turned bad. But the overall effect of this way of dealing with this report and what was revealed in the report, and it is revealed, the systematic mass killings, has been swept under the rug. So the question is, I think that's where I'm going to come back and say, well, what really happened? The position I defend is that Paul Kagame, the current RPF, was always the bad guy, right from the beginning. And it was well known. It was well known to the State Department. It was well known to the American administration and to the British as well. I would say that this strategy, which has wreaked havoc on the whole of Central Africa, began in Washington in about 1988 under the aegis of the Bush 1 government, or Bush 1 when he was coming to power in 88-89. And Roger Winters, who organized what they would call the refugee elements who had left Rwanda as of 1960, when Rwanda had become independent and there had been a social revolution, and mainly Tutsi members of the Rwandan population, and they met and developed a strategy in the late 80s, and that strategy involved an invasion. Invasion of Rwanda from Uganda. And that was a real invasion, aggression of a foreign army. 4,000 troops, members of the Ugandan army, wearing uniforms of the, left their barracks and went across the border and invaded Rwanda. The leader at that time was a guy named Fred Rwigema, who was Minister of Defense of the Ugandan government. The number two man was Paul Kagame, who at that moment was training at Fort Leavenworth in Kansas. Now, Fort Leavenworth is not a minor logistics operation in military terms. It is for major strategic operations. He was trained there. So after the invasion, he went there. Fred Rwigema was killed, and Paul Kagame became the military leader. They had a number of civilian leaders just for the show. Now, when that invasion occurred, they were pushed back by the Rwandan government. But the reaction was extremely dubious. You had the Americans offered asylum to the President Habyarimana, who just happened to be here at the UN, here in New York. They offered him asylum. They thought that the RPF, the Rwandan Patriotic Front, was going to go right through to Kigali. The Belgians also offered him asylum. He didn't want asylum, and in fact, they fought it back. But they immediately, and this is an invasion. I mean, the description is like any invasion, and any a major crime, an aggression against the peace, breaking the peace. You invade the country wearing uniforms, supported, armed, right? Well armed by the Ugandan government. Anywhere else in the world, that would be an invasion. It would be condemned. This was 2 months after Iraq invaded Kuwait. What happened to Iraq? It was bombed to smithereens. After that, that was a reason, a casus belli. But here you have the Ugandan government, Ugandan troops, and these were all troops who'd been the backbone of Museveni's government that had taken power in 1986, and they invade Rwanda. Herman Cohen, who was the man, Bush One administration's man for Africa, described this as the first day of the crisis, an invasion. The New York Times at a later time, and one of those huge splash articles they had, they said tensions increased between Hutus and Tutsis after October 1st. Tensions increased, yet you have an invasion. And the big powers, and I would say mainly the United States, England, but France as well, decided to say, okay, well, we're going to treat this as an Rwandan affair, an internal Rwandan affair, which was the first big error. Instead of saying this government has a right to fight them back and kick them out of the country, and even in fact make sure that doesn't happen again, but the big powers said, no, you're going to start negotiating. You're going to have to negotiate with these people. In fact, and then at the same time, you had the RPF operating with a fifth column. We all know what the fifth column is. The fifth column operating within the Rwandan state. This is extremely well documented, by the way. There was a guy named Valens Kajekakwa. He was a leading man, Tutsi, who was in the Habyarimana government. And he wrote a book, because he ended up being exiled, and he explained all the networks they had operating with the RPF from and being directed and being activated by the RPF within Rwanda. This was starting in 1990. And at that time, they were doing a lot of recruitment. They were recruiting among the Tutsi families and having them, young people would say, okay, you've got to go and join the RPF. So they would leave the country and they would come back and they would be fighting continually against the Rwandan government. At that time, what Herman Cohen did, and of course, parallel to this, and I think it's important to understand, for during the Cold War for about 25, 30 years, the Western powers were very happy to have one-party systems. It was their way of stopping the advance of communism. And so that's what you had, and everybody was happy with it. The Western powers liked it. But with at the end of the Cold War, they all decide, well, right now we're in favor of democracy. We have to have a multi-party system. So François Mitterrand made his famous speech at La Baule in June 1990 and said, okay, well, you want to get help from us, you've got to have a multi-party system. Well, here you have, shortly after that, the war begins, and they force Rwanda to have a multi-party system. Now, a multi-party system all of a sudden becomes like warlords, or else you have parties, political parties, that are just a shell. And one of the ways they operate is to get attention from embassies. That's they don't have any mass support. They're not political parties like we could have or like have elsewhere. What it is you get a bunch of people say, well, we're going to start a party, and how do they get recognition? They get recognition from the embassies, and they get recognition from human rights groups, and they get money from countries saying, we're going to help. So you had a period there, 1991, 1992, and Habyarimana, who was the president at the time of Rwanda, said, okay, we'll go along, and we'll go along with what the French tell us to do. We have to observe the multi-party system. But you see, one of the ways that the imperialists operated, the Americans, in fact, Herman Cohen organized a meeting. Now, you're having a murderous war going on. Part of the territory is occupied since October 1990. and Herman Cohen organized a meeting between the RPF and the opposition parties in Belgium. Now, it is something, you know, you have an invasive war. I mean, can you imagine Pearl Harbor? You have, invasion of the United States, and the opposition party says, well, we're going to go and work with the invading party, with the invading country. That is exactly what Herman Cohen and the Americans did when they organized this meeting, and it really got people angry. Really got people very angry. And of course, people have since ethnicized what was going on. And you know, I mean, if you're involved in politics, I know it very well from our Quebec politics, people know what their neighbors' political persuasions are. Well, it's the same thing in Rwanda, especially in a tight society like that. You know who's on whose side. And here you have an army there carrying out a war, and it's very, very devastating because you've had whole parts of the northeastern part of Rwanda are being emptied of the population. They're not producing anymore. You have the structural adjustment program. If you remember, what that was, one of these things, SAP they called it, when the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank said you have to basically privatize all your system and all your economic system in that period. And if you didn't do it, you didn't get any credits. So here you had Rwanda losing losing some of the aid it was getting. At the same time, Uganda, because it officially had lost a certain number of troops, because the troops were no longer officially in the Ugandan army, they had their credits going up because they had less money going into the army. So their credits went up and Rwanda's went down. So this just made it even worse for the Rwandans in this war against basically what was the Ugandan army. And so what you had, Herman Cohen sets up this meeting, and that's what really got people's backs up. And you might say that as well, they had these, in 1990, the RPF had 36 clandestine cells. This is their own documentation, and they start boasting about after, but 36 clandestine underground cells operating in Kigali, in Rwanda. By 1993, that was 146 cells operating in Rwanda at the time. I don't know when the Black Panthers existed, how many cells they had, or whether underground exists, how many cells they had. But you can imagine 146 cells doing violent things, bombing, selective assassinations, operating like that. I know that in Quebec in the 1960s, there was what we called the Front de Libération du Québec, the FLQ. There were two cells, and the Canadian government sent the army in and occupied all of Quebec and arrested 500 people, poets, trade unionists, and so on. So in other words, here you have 146 cells operating and doing all kinds of things in Rwanda. I would say then one of the major events was the arrival of the human rights organizations. Now this is something that I think I know that Ed Herman in his book, The Politics of Genocide, refers to it, but I think it's a very, very important turning point. This is where you had Human Rights Watch, what we call Droit et Démocratie, working out of Montreal, and the International Federation of Human Rights decided to go on a fact-finding mission to examine human rights violations in Rwanda from October 1st until the present. This was January 1993. Now, I analyzed that report, who was in it and what happened, but it was a major turning point. That was where Alison Desforges, if you've probably seen her cited about Rwanda, she became the official person you had to quote if you're talking about Rwanda. She was one of the leaders in it. She was with Human Rights Watch. William Chabas from Montreal, several other people who've since become very important. And they went for 2 weeks. Some of them had never even set foot in Africa. William Chabas, for instance, was the first man to use the term genocide as a human rights organization at the time. He had never set foot in Africa before that. And they didn't know anything about it. Very few of them did. And they went and they spent 2 weeks there. They spent 2 hours in the area occupied by the RPF. just 2 hours, under close RPF supervision. In other words, they couldn't really question people. And then the other 2 weeks they spent, and they had complete freedom of operation throughout Rwanda. Those who had invited them, and it turned out after, they were immediately became members of the RPF government. The people who had been in these human rights organizations who had invited them said they were actually working for the RPF. All this came out. And each one of the members ended up in different capacities working for the government after 1994. Shabas wrote the so-called genocide law. They became, after that, they remind me of, you know, the Miserables, what's his name, Javert, you know, going after Jean Valjean. They're in on every case, in every place in the world, trying to indict, trying to prosecute people for crimes that in many cases there's absolutely no proof at all. And these are the people, these are human rights people. Now, they made the report, and immediately when they left the country, in February 1993, immediately when they left, they hadn't even submitted their report, the RPF launched a major offensive and pushed right down to Kigali. From, you know, if you can imagine the map, from the northwest and right down to Kigali. And there you have reports, and the reports have come out, and anybody who wanted to know it could know these things, of systematic massacres, the same kind, the same way, that are being reported in this mapping exercise that just came out now. The same way that they were actually massacring the peasant population, mostly Hutus, and they were going about doing it. It was like a burned earth policy. The population, the civilian population of Rwanda was being pushed down towards Kigali to the point that by March 1994, you had 1.5 million internal refugees around living in camps around Kigali, not going to school. And Rwandans have big families. They have 5, 6, 7, that's an ordinary family, children. None of them are going to school, young people. Mad, lost, they don't have their land, and you can see that the actual, it's like a tinderbox, this part of the population. Now, the reason, the RPF, when they launched that offensive, and it was one of the major offensives, they said it's because of this report, because of what had been revealed by the human rights groups. Now, the human rights groups were actually working for them. It's clear that they were working for them, so they provided the justification. Right after that, Belgium recalled its ambassador, and Belgium became sort of the cat's paw for the Americans in there. And Canada. Canada suspended all aid to Rwanda. Canada, in Quebec in particular, because of the French language, had been a major player in the development of Rwanda. And there was a Quebecers who had founded the National University of Rwanda in the 60s. And so Canada suspended all aid. The report became the official, was quoted, it's still quoted today. It was in all the foreign affairs departments throughout the world. It was here at the UN. That report became the damning document for the Habyarimana government. Yet it was a shoddy report, and many analyses of it, how it was done by people who have taken human rights seriously, have said this was just of no value at all. But it was there that Alison DeForge got her name. You know, it was through that report there. So that was 1993. You have a situation which is explosive. You have a quarter of the country is occupied by this invading army. And you have this huge amount of population who are sort of like not knowing what to do. You have an army which is demoralized because they don't even pay the army anymore, the Rwandan army. You have some, this was a French proposal, but the Americans and the British went along with it. It was called the Arusha Accords. The Arusha Accords were signed in the summer of 1993. And under those accords, they were going to set up a peacekeeping force. It became the UNAMIR, where, if you know about Dallaire, our general, became head of that peacekeeping force. And that was decided in August 1993. Now, that accord basically took all power away from the Habyarimana government. The army was going to be the new, and they were going to set up a, it was a new, it was going to be a power-sharing agreement. But the army had been emasculated, if you could use the, want to use the word. The army was now, the RPF was going to be integrated into the Rwandan army. It was something that was really, really unacceptable. Yet, it was going to be a power-sharing agreement. But then something important happened that fall. So the, this agreement and the UNAMIR, with Dallaire leading it, the United Nations force was there to enforce that agreement and ensure that we could go ahead with this power-sharing agreement, a broad-based government. But in September 93, they had an area which was demilitarized between the RPF forces and the government, and they had elections, communal elections there. Well, the RPF ran candidates, and the RPF, Kagame's party, just got beaten completely. There was no way that the population would vote for them. Now, this is the party, the army, which had been, according to Philip Gurevich and other authors, became a liberation army, just completely defeated in local elections. And so it became very clear that the RPF, there's no way they could take power other than through, by armed force. They could not win. So if you had a power-sharing agreement, and then you set up elections, well, the RPF would be defeated. It was just clear as anything. And then in October 1993, and it might be quite complicated, but in Burundi, neighboring Burundi, which has a similar population breakdown of Tutsis and Hutus, they had had for the first time in their history, and they had had some terrible massacres against the Hutu population in the 70s. They had elected the first Hutu president, and the Hutus were 80%, 85% of the population, but the Tutsis controlled the army. And they had done a lot of massacres. So they elected this Melchior Ndadaye, and he was elected, but he was assassinated on October 21st, 1993, the day when the troops arrived. The troops were arriving in Rwanda. Now, the RPF people, when the president of Burundi was, they had bases in Burundi. The RPF were overjoyed at this killing, but it was very, very disappointing for the rest of the population of Rwanda to see this. They had hoped that maybe if we would go through elections, you know, the Western powers said elections are the way to go. That's the only way you're going to have a democracy. You're going to have elections, and they were looking forward to it. Well, here the guy got assassinated. Basically, nothing was done. Nobody investigated what had happened, how it happened. And the man who did it ended up being in power and was very close to the United States. Then you're getting closer to the period 1994. According to the Arusha Agreement, the RPF would have their troops brought into Kigali. Now, there was very strict way in how this was going. They had a certain number of troops, certain number of weapons they could bring, and they were brought down into Kigali under the escort of the United Nations. They set up in what was the official, was the parliament building. So here you have armed members of the RPF, mostly Tutsis, setting up right in the heart of Kigali. Now, they had very strict limits, but of course, the UN people there, and I've interviewed them and have interviews, and unfortunately, the books are in French, with some of the people who were involved in the intelligence for the UN, they said from the beginning, the RPF did not respect the limits, did not honor their commitments. And they brought in a lot more troops, and the troops would get in there, and then they would exfiltrate. They would move into the population, and then they would start carrying out selective assassinations, bombings, and they had many more arms. They're bringing in rocket launchers. This is coming from Amadou Dem, who was the information officer with the United Nations there. Senegalese, a member of the Senegalese army who was with, who was under Dallaire, and they had rocket launchers, much more arms. That really, they only had the right to have small arms when they moved down into Kigali, and here they had rocket launchers. That brings us up to just the period prior to April 6th, when the president's plane was shot down. President Habyarimana's plane was shot down. Now, the information is very clear that troops were moving from Uganda into Rwanda before the plane came down. There was advanced knowledge that the plane was, that the president of Rwanda was going to be shot, was going to be assassinated, and so that on April 6th, there was a meeting organized, which Mobutu was supposed to go to as well with Habyarimana. Mobutu didn't go. Habyarimana went to it, and then they managed to dilly dally, and there was a meeting in Dar es Salaam. And he ended up having to leave after it got dark, which was against all security regulations. And he flew in, and his plane was shot down with the head of the army and a number of other very important people. So it was the government was decapitated. At the same time, the army, the RPF, was moving, and the troops who were stationed, who were only supposed to be lightly unarmed in the heart of Kigali, were started sending their rocket launchers. So they had been looking for a way to resume the war because they knew that they could not win an election. And that's what happened starting on April 6th. The Rwandan army at that time wanted to sued for peace. They wanted to get a ceasefire. And the documents are all there. So these have been presented to court. And it's very clear that they wanted to peace. They had no interest in resuming the war. They were trying to apply the Arusha agreements. The official story told by the official historian, Philip Gurevich, I think he's probably the one who's quoted the most, is of course that army came swooping down to protect the population and stop the extermination of the Tutsi population. That is a total lie. That operation looked more like the one they called shock and awe than in Iraq, than an operation to protect the innocent Tutsi population. There was, during that period, a lot of massacres going on from both sides because and people were out of control, but the people who have been arrested and taken to the court are not the ones who are committed those massacres. When you think of these of militias and population with completely not working, having been unseated, taken out of their homes and their land for 2-3 years, and living in camps around Kigali, anything can happen. You had refugees from Burundi who had been there from before. You know, Hutu refugees who've taken refuge from the army of Burundi, and then ones who'd also come after the assassination of their president. These people were not going to give in easily to the advancing army of the RPF. And so you had a lot of killing going on. Now, one of the things that we were talking to me about at the beginning was Bhutto's galley, how come he could say that the Rwandan genocide was 100% American responsibility? He told me that. I interviewed him twice. He had said something and I found it quoted, and so I wrote to him and asked, would you agree to an interview? And I went and met him in Paris twice. And twice he said the same thing. It was 100% American responsibility. Now why? Because when, after April 6th, there were countries, France, Nigeria, I think, and South Africa, who wanted to act, who wanted to send in an forced interposition, in other words, forces to stop the fighting, settle in. And the Americans at that time And this is very clear that they were saying, they were ordering, and this was Madeleine Albright, and saying that the UN, the US at the UN had to insist that all UN troops be withdrawn from Rwanda. I mean, it was clear as that. And Bhutto's Ghali said that in the Security Council, it was the United States, and with the help of Great Britain, that ensured that nothing was done in that period. Now, why? Of course, the question, the why, is because they did not want a power-sharing agreement. They wanted a decisive victory from the RPF. Because, and this is, came out, and in fact, some people, I found quotes where people said, the invasion of October 1st, 1990, was not aimed at Kigali, but was aimed at Kinshasa. And I think after that, and I'll speak briefly about what happened in the Congo, but the objective was to create this axis in the center of Africa, the Museveni regime, the Kagame regime, and a regime like that in Burundi, who could make the law in the whole of Central Africa. People have compared the Rwandan regime to the Israeli regime and to the Colombian regime, that they, with a very powerful army, you know, there's 100,000 members of the Rwandan army, you know, 100,000. Canada has an army of 50,000. Rwanda is a tiny country, 100,000 soldiers. It's a big army, a very powerful army. So the U.S. position was the UN was not to move at all. They dithered for about 2 or 3 weeks about whether we should use the genocide word or not. They didn't want to use it at first because it would mean having to do something, which would mean, in other words, the UN would have to get involved. So they fought against using it. But once the RPF was taking power, then they decided this was the best thing to do. And so they fought to make it apply to this. And of course, the danger with a word like that is that it makes like there's good guys and bad guys. It also debases the one major genocide of that people agree upon, which I still don't like use the word, but the killing of the Jews by the Nazis, because there's absolutely no comparison. But then, of course, the people who had to make the story stick started making this comparison, and there was a famous meeting in 1995. Where the Saul Wiesenthal Center agreed that the Rwandans could talk about genocide, because many people said this cannot be reserved, this term cannot be used for other situations. They agreed that it could be used. You had people like Philip Gurevich who started trying to find a Schindler, and that's where Hotel Rwanda came from, because that was a creation of Philip Gurevich. It's in his book. That we had to create a Schindler person. You know, and the problem with Paul Rusesabagina, who is the hero that Don Cheadle played, is that he's still alive. Schindler died, so we don't know what he thought. But Paul Rusesabagina all of a sudden became public enemy number one of the Rwandan regime, because he said, well, yeah, I was the head of that hotel, and we managed to save all these people. But he said, the biggest criminal is Paul Kagame. Well, now, wherever Paul Rusesabagina goes, he's followed by the embassy. In other words, they've had people attack his home and destroy his home in Brussels. That's unfortunate for the Schindler position, because of course his story is not what people would like it to be. He was a hero. Bush received him at the White House, but now nobody wants to receive him anywhere. He has a very hard time. So the other thing is, I just want to finish with two points. The ICTR is a case of victor's justice. It has taken, it has decided to be selective justice, selective prosecution, and selective impunity. So it's something that should not be taken seriously, in my opinion. Everybody started, when they started setting up the ICTR, they started referring to Nuremberg. Well, Nuremberg was victor's justice, but it did have certain accomplishments, Nuremberg. But the major One of the major conclusions of Nuremberg was that the worst crime is the crime against peace. And I'll quote Judge Burkett. He said, "The charges in the indictment that the defendants planned and waged aggressive wars are the charges of utmost gravity. To initiate a war of aggression, therefore, is not only an international crime, it is the supreme international crime, differing only from the other war crimes in that it contains within itself the accumulated evil of the whole." In other words, the biggest crime was the invasion on October 1st, 1990, because without that invasion, the rest would not have happened, would not have occurred. Yet the ICTR does not, it has recused itself. It has said, we cannot discuss this. The human rights organizations, Alison DeForge, was asked why didn't they deal with that question? And they said, it's not in our mandate. But not in our mandate. Okay, we'll talk about the invasion of Iraq. Sorry, it's not in our mandate. We have to look about how the war is conducted. We will not look at who committed the major crime. Congo happened 2 years later, in 96. It was the invasion of Congo. There were 2 million refugees there, and that invasion is well described in the report, in the UN report. Canada played a very important role there because the United States was operating in French-speaking Africa. They needed a French face, and they knew they could find that in Ottawa, not in Quebec City, but they could find it in Ottawa. People who are French-speaking, some people who are French-speaking, who speak French, but who are anti-France. The United States had to get France out of that area, and which is what they succeeded in doing, and one of the ways they did it was to use Canada as a front. The similar kind of thing happened in the Congo. The RPF entered with, as it turns out, support of the United States. They entered, they started bombing the camps against any charters that exist in the world of charters of bombing camps or forcing refugees to return. Everybody got excited. Jean Chrétien, who was Prime Minister of Canada, said, but this is all for the show, because of course it was all decided in advance, that Clinton said, I can't do this, you see. So you'll say that you convinced all the middle powers to form a force that will go in there and settle between the people who are being attacked and the RPF. And so he said, okay, we'll do that, because why? And this is one thing that Guto's Gali explained to me, was that, of course, once again, France and South Africa wanted to set up another force. But the Americans would not allow France and South Africa to have a force. It had to be basically the Americans. But the Canadians could be the front people, and which is what they agreed to do. So this bombing was going on, and then followed by the massacres. But the UN troops were deployed to Kampala in Uganda. They never went any further, because Maurice Barry, who was head of that, was going to head that troop, got a ride through the area where the refugees were, and he said, the refugees have all gone back. It's over. So this was a stillborn UN force, which could have stopped a lot of those massacres. It could have prevented what has been revealed in this mapping exercise. It was a terrible show, because, I mean, the Canada just played a disgusting role of playing a front man for the United States. Finally, I'll say that the title Colonialism Dies Hard, you have right now these courts, they have kind of penal colonies. You know, they will arrest people, they will try them, and they'll send them off to another country. You know, I mean, Rwandans now who have been arrested and tried and found guilty without then most of them are it's most of the cases, they're very unfounded. Are sent off to Mali. You'll have people who are arrested in Sierra Leone who are sent in Rwanda. I mean, this is something that comes out of, this was done in the colonial periods. That's how you get rid of people. You'd have them arrested here, you'd move them over there, just basically get them out of contact with the rest of the population. And the vocabulary, the language describing these events, and that was in my book, it was a part of a whole section, is that basically there's this wonderful book by Dorothy Hammond and Jablo. It's called The Africa That Never Was. And they analyzed the literature English literature, basically, from 1560 to 1960. And they managed to find a set of conventions, images, metaphors that exist in all this literature. And it basically to make Africa into other, into a non-human and different humanity, different type of humanity. Well, if you go through the literature about Rwanda, starting with Gurevich, you'll find exactly the same images that basically were used to justify slavery and colonialism. So that is my idea, that colonialism does die hard. We thought it was over in 1960, but it's not over at all. Thank you very much.
One of Kagame's excuses for incursions over the border of Congo and so on is not only preemptive strikes, but in retaliation, he says, for bands that actually have crossed the other direction. Is there any information as to whether this has occurred or to what about, you know, are we talking about 50 troops crossing the Interahamwe, crossing over into Rwanda, or 100 or 1,000 or anything like that? Any documentation or information on that?
I'm not aware of them actually doing that. They did try to reorganize as a society, and which is what, of course, Kagame couldn't put up with. Is it? And it's very normal that they try and reorganize, and that sometimes they would organize with the same people. I mean, everybody knew, would know who, and the same people would take sign of responsibility to make sure that the people got their basic necessities. And there was, I'm sure there were attempts. I mean, it became a bit of almost like a Palestinian situation there. And I think that it is a potential situation like that, like the Palestinian situation that exists there. I'm not aware of actually doing it. And I think that every time it's been said we had to go there to go after the génocidaires, as they used, they've changed the name, it's become an English word as well. I think that's just a red herring. There's no justification to that. It's their goal, and I understand Keith Harmon Snow talked about that a few weeks ago, but their goal is to control the eastern part of the Congo. And so if they have a reason, then that's what it is. That's the reason they've always used. That's why they started invading in 1996. That's why, and that's how they overthrew the government and put in their man in Kinshasa. They said we had to chase these people. And of course they did chase them, and they killed a lot of people. But as whether they reorganized and were able to attack, I don't think they were really. I mean, not that they were not going to do that. All I can say is that in a sense you might say they would have the right to do that. They've been chased out of their country, so they might have the right to do it. But I'm not aware of the info for that.
There's just another angle, by the way. Another angle that has suggested itself here is that there's a lot of buildup in the Kivu region, the Kivu province, and so on, and a lot of attacks on civilians by the Congo army, as well as the RPF and so on. And the suspicion that some people, I think, have expressed is that they really want to change the electorate, move in people who might vote in the election next year to support Joseph Kabila.
Mm-hmm. I think that's very possible. That's very possible. It's a sort of a de facto dismantling of the Congolese state. We have a lot of Congolese people in Montreal, and they keep us informed about it, and they say that basically the state doesn't exist, which is in some ways what the big powers want. They want a non-existent state. They do not want that state to operate because they can rape the country of its wealth. Exactly. Which is what they and so that if they can move people around right now, Goma, which is a big city in the east, they have major highway going into Kigali. That, in other words, the everything's changed. You know, in other words, you're not the links between the East and the capital are just basically broken down. So it's a de facto dismantling of the state.
Let me say at the outset that I'm a layman, and I'm sort of here by almost by accident for your lecture, which I enjoy very much. But the kind of information I have about this conflict, let's say, is the kind of information that I read in the New York Times and other papers. And the impression that I got until this evening, it was that the mass killings of the Hutus were sort of one-on-one attacks of Hutus on Tutsis not with guns, but with pitchforks and clubs and other kind of vile instruments. And that's opposite, totally, sort of opposite. I'm totally unaware of the story that you're telling. So can you please discuss, why is it that the mass media in the United States are presented the story that I had first mentioned?
Yeah, because of course that makes it easier to cover up their own iniquity. If you have the story of these dark crowds who go around with machetes killing, and motivated by this terrible, basically they take Conrad images, Heart of Darkness images to describe it. The thing is, what kind of weapon, what kind of killing is worse, rocket launchers or a machete? What happened when things broke down? People defended themselves with the weapons they had, when there was mass killing by Hutu population, and they would victimize Tutsis. That is not debated. That is a fact. The question is, was that planned, and how did that come about, and where? And that has not really been addressed.
When we understand it, was that this radio broadcast that the Hutu leader was urging the Tutsu.
The point is, the people who were arrested, people who went to prison, and the people who have been tried have all been exonerated for planning the killing. In other words, they have after 15 years of court hearings, they have yet to convict anybody of having planned to eliminate the Tutsis. That's been said, the press continues saying it, but they have not found that in courts. So that's a fact. What I'm saying is that you had a long war going on. You had a fifth column operating. You had clandestine cells, and the people who have described what they were doing, in other words, people who now are exiled, and they were Tutsis, and they described what they were doing. I mean, they were going around doing a selective assassinations, placing bombs for the RPF. Now, the population knows who those people are and who their families are. They would go after them. They would say those are the people who are with the invading army. Now, I'm not saying that they were right, but there was a lot of killing, and it was not necessarily ethnic. It was political. I mean, that's an important point. If my books, I do not deal with the question of Hutu and Tutsi, virtually not, because you're dealing with political issues here. You have an invading army. There's a famous historian of Rwanda, René Le Marchand, who taught at Florida University. He says that Rwanda is the only place in Africa, perhaps, maybe with the exclusion of Zanzibar, that had a real social revolution with independence. They actually had a change of the social order from a feudal Tutsi aristocracy who ran the place for 200 or 300 years to a republic where the mass of the population, the Hutu population, had finally were able to get to school and get some control of the society. That happened in the 1960s. And what you had as of 1990 is like a counter-revolution that what was going on. So it's very easy to say, well, there's people, these terrible people, but nobody explains about how that happened. Why did people get to that point? And if we start interviewing a lot of the people, they saw that we had a return to a situation where the Hutu population were serfs to the Tutsi aristocrats. They saw it as that. And I've met so many people who said that when they knew that this was a return to a period, it's like a counter-revolution. I mean, you know, the French had it in the French Revolution. I think you had it here coming basically from Canada against the American Revolution. I mean, that's what was going on. That's the background. And people are upset about machetes, and I think it's very upsetting, but rocket launchers are equally bad.
Okay, while we get ready for our next question, I would like you to comment and elaborate more on what we have referred to, or what is sometimes referred to as a resource war that is going on in that part of Africa.
Resource war. Okay.
The resource war and the connection between the resources in that region and the various factions.
You know, the person who you should perhaps invite is Cynthia McKinney. Cynthia McKinney was, she's a wonderful woman. I had the honor of translating her speech into French at the French National Assembly in France. And she was speaking, it was wonderful. But she believed that Clinton was doing the right thing in 1994, 1995, 1996. I'm getting the question of resources. And so she went there, and she was going there to defend Laurent Désiré Kabila, the father, who was put into power by the RPF. And then she travels through, and then she realized that she was on a plane that was chartered by the American Mineral Fields, which is a Canadian mining company. This was in 1996, at the time when the invasion had taken place. And that was when all these mining companies were signing contracts with Kabila for control of all kinds of mineral resources. So her description of that is, and witnessed in the Spanish courts. I haven't told, that was another aspect, but because the RPF had killed some Spanish nationals, a number of Catalan and Basque people and lawyers took up a court case against Kagame. And they have this tremendous body of testimony about, and it's available because, in fact, that court, judge, has indicted 40 leaders of the Kagame government. And they have this tremendous body of testimony about the resource wars. I haven't studied. I mean, I've been involved. There's been books written about it in Canada and French. In fact, they've been had major court cases, a libel or slap suits against some fellow friends of who've written this book called Noir Canada, the story about Canadian mining companies. Because Canada is a haven for mining companies. The Toronto Stock Exchange is a place where they have, you could call it a mining company's haven. And American companies will go and settle. Will all go and list there. Be listed in the Toronto Stock Exchange, and they're the ones who are very much involved. And so there's a tremendous wealth in Eastern Congo, and I would say that's a background to it. Where I might differ with some people is that it's an imperial war we're going on here. It's, in other words, the mining companies don't do it. It's the countries, it's the political forces that the governments who are doing this. And sometimes the mining companies will be at odds with the government. I mean, they're not doing this. They're one of the reasons that it's to have control over that. But you're actually having imperial operations going on, mainly the Americans and the British, and the French are trying to come in now because on their coattails, the French have basically backed down from the position they had before. So I'm not sure that really answered, but I don't think the resources are an extremely important element, And that's what's going on. That's why the dismantling is taking place of the states. But I think that, that what you have is imperial, the way imperialists have operated throughout history.
Do we have anybody for a question?
I just have a follow-up question.
Okay. Yeah.
You just give us your name and...
My name's Casey Butcher. I was just listening to that. I was wondering, like, would this be going on at all, though, if there were no resources? Obviously, there's, like, you know, like a formal separation between the mining interests or the oil interests, the, whatever the interests are of extracting resources in these, you know, private entities or international companies, and these imperialist governments. We also know a lot about how close those entities come together. And so, I mean, the point really is ultimately getting at the resources. Like you said, they've created a political vacuum so they can, you know, rape the land of its resources, basically, at will. Yes, there's kind of a formal separation, but there's also kind of, if there were no resources, I don't think this would be going on, right? I
mean, it would probably be that, although, you know, everybody said, well, why are they fighting? Why did the Americans want Rwanda? The point is that empires abhor vacuums. In other words, you know, the Americans from the 1990 on, if you look at the speeches by Warren Christopher and a couple other they're sitting there attacking France. They said there's no way that these people should, you know, France has its influence in West Africa. It's an imperial power. But they wanted to get France out of there. Now, its interest, it's a broad interest. It's not, I just don't see it as being simple economic determinism. It's like, you know, I don't want to let the political leaders off the hook and just say it's just some companies. Those companies are an important part. And Cynthia McKinney's description of how she found herself on this plane chartered, this is like when the invasion was going on, it tells you a lot. And you know these people, but they don't going to do it by themselves. You've got to have the Pentagon, you've got to have the White House, you've got to have the National Security Council, and you know they're the ones who are saying this is the way we're going to do things. They're the ones we have to speak to, in my opinion. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Russell Dale. You already met me. I just wanted to ask you if you could talk a little bit about the Gersony report and what its significance is, you know, what it was, what it is, what its significance is, whether what happened to it, what the history was, and how it was denied, and is the newly available report the Gersony report?
Well, I think that the Gersony report, maybe I should just say what it was. The Gersony was a UN investigator August through October 1994. And he discovered that there was these systematic massacres being carried out by the RPF.
That is Tutsi against Hutu.
Well, no, it's RPF against the population, because there were, you know, the leader of the Interahamwe was a Tutsi, Robert Kajuga, and there were Tutsis at all different places. I mean, it's just, this is politics, you know.
It's not ethnic.
No, it's not ethnic, it's politics. And so it was the RPF conducted these massacres, and the report was then disappeared. There were people who'd seen it. I've met people who were in fact in the government of Rwanda and who are exiled as of 1995. They were in the RPF government and they read it, they'd seen it, and they had to disappear. So it did disappear then. There was another report, I would say what has been come out in this mapping exercise. There are elements that are in it. In other words, the system, the way that the massacres, the way the killings are done. You know, we heard about, you heard it, if you, there's a very good book by a woman, her name is Beatrice Umutesi. She said, it was called Fuir ou Mourir au Zaire. But she lived in northern Rwanda, and she describes in there how the massacres were conducted by the RPF in 1993 before the assassination of the president. And then she describes how these things that were going on in the Gersonis discovered, and she describes it in detail about what happened in the Congo. Her book was published by the University of Iowa Press, but it was not distributed. It's available in English, and I do recommend it. But so the Gersoni report was snuffed out. Then there was a report by Roberto Garton about massacres in the Congo. Same story. The report was basically disappeared. So right now you have this report coming out, but then the debate about it was basically an erudite debate about a genocide, but people are not stopping saying, well, were these massacres conducted? Did they kill these people? Was it systematic? How long did it go on? Why? And of course, those questions are not being answered, and not even being asked in most cases, because they have people in power who are advising them. And I mean, it's not a minor thing that Clinton and Blair are both working, you could say, on Kagame's payroll. But they may, I think Blair said he would just take a dollar a year, you know. But that explains the silence about it. And so I think you might say that this report means that there are people who are saying we can't keep hiding this, you know, the fact that this report was done. And it should be something we should talk about. But we can't overestimate the effect of such a report.
Recently it's been said that there's this report that's being called the Gersoni report, and it's floating around the internet.
Yeah.
Is that the actual Gersoni report? Is that?
I couldn't tell you. But I could find that out, because I have a lot of friends who are much closer, like Rwandans and others who just are on. But I can't say it. It could be a report, because when I read that report, I mean, it's these are things, you know, they're absolutely disgusting. But I can't see why is people get stopped saying we have to discuss the genocide word. I mean, does this happen? Why did this happen? Is it a good guy gone bad? No. And that's why but the point is that in order to answer that question, you have to go right back to 20 years before and figure out where it all started. That's what I was, sort of the message that I would have today is that you have to go back to there. Sorry.
No, thank you. I have a follow-up question.
Sure.
And one that I'll make a little comment very briefly beforehand that may deal with some of what Casey and some others were talking about. You had said yourself, this is with regard to the question of why Rwanda. What does the United States see in Rwanda?
Yeah.
You had said yourself that the United States perhaps wants an access in the middle of Africa, say, from Uganda to Rwanda to Burundi,
yeah.
And now extending to some degree, to a large degree, in Congo as well.
Mm-hmm.
But also, we now see that the United States supports the separation of southern Sudan from Sudan. And I don't know if you've heard this, but I've heard this a number of times, that the AFRICOM is going to move into southern Sudan. AFRICOM has not been in Africa, because no AFRICOM is a U.S. military control formation equivalent to such formations they have for Europe and Asia. I'm saying that for the benefit of people who might not understand what I mean by that. It's not been allowed in Africa, and no African country will have it. So now, with U.S. support of South Sudan, which it so happens as well is where all of the Sudanese oil is, or most of it, the United States is supporting the separation of South Sudan from Sudan, and rumor has it that AFRICOM is likely to move there.
Mm-hmm.
So we see this axis maybe growing a little larger right now.
Yeah.
And
there people have said that the reason they were back Museveni was because, you know, you have two huge countries, not just two, but you have Sudan is the biggest country in Africa, biggest country, one of the richest countries as well. Now, once again, it's like big countries with independent states that decide they're not going to march to their marching orders, empires hate that. I mean, in other words, they would like to dismantle Sudan. They do not want Sudan to be able to operate independently of them. And so one of the ways will be AFRICOM. They also do not want the Chinese them to be able to deal with the Chinese. And so one of the ways is to have a war festering or breaking down of the state of the Sudan. So, I mean, I think one of the points is that, and this was Bhutto's galley, I sort of led him to it, but then he spoke about it a lot. Fashoda. Do you know the Fashoda incident? 1898? The British wanted to go from the Cape to Cairo, and the French wanted to go from Dakar to Djibouti. And where did they meet? They met at Fashoda. It was the Fashoda incident, 1898. And the British pushed back the French. And it was a psychological, this was 1898, just before the Dreyfus affair. It was a major setback for France. France had, felt terrible with this Fashoda incident. And it was, a lot of it was symbolic, but it was the British beat the French right at that place in Sudan. It's in Sudan. And I asked him about that, and he said, oh yes, he said, Rwanda is like Fashoda. So it is imperial operations. It's not just economics. It's empires. Empires will follow the commerce, but they do operate it. And having a setback, Rwanda was a setback for France, major setback, and it made them they had tremendous battles, political battles in France now, where you have guys and now the, in other words, you have a real flip flop of political positions, with Sarkozy and Kushner. So anyway, all I'm saying is that the Fashoda incident is very interesting, and Bhutto's galley, he agreed it, because of course Fashoda is important for an Egyptian, that knowing that story. And so I really do think that what you're having here is you're trying to have control of Africa, and it's imperial control of Africa.
I think you should point out that one of the uses that Rwanda serves, it supplies troops to intervene in the southern Sudan situation.
And in the western as well, yeah. And
similarly, you have Museveni supplying troops in Somalia.
Yeah.
And as I pointed out the other day, I guess what Keith Harmon Snow is here, if you're just fixated on Africa, you don't notice that right across from Somalia, you have Yemen.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens there in Rwanda and Uganda has implications for Sudan and for Yemen.
Sure it does. I read an interview, which I recommend, if you know Quincy Troop, Quincy Troop's Renaissance, Black Renaissance, Ishmael Reed interviewed a Somalia Islam leader. And he describes exactly where this piracy comes from and what's going on and how the imperial countries are in fact what's going on in Somalia and how they've created warlords and the link between Somalia and Yemen. But all that to say, I mean, I don't want to play down the importance of resources. It is very important, but this is a pattern of imperial, not war all the time, but imperial conflict, which is something which characterized the First World War, the period prior to the First World War, the scramble for Africa, 1880s, and this is what's going on now. And I think we have to follow it, look at the who's what the politics of it all are.
I'm just wondering, can you briefly comment on Darfur and how it fits into this wider picture?
I may be a little flippant, but Darfur is largely a Zionist creation, an Israeli creation. They want to have a place to say, stop looking at Palestine, look what's going on here. Darfur is the western part of Sudan. There is oil, among other things, that you'd like to bring it down through the Cameroon and not have it go through, go east, where it would, that's one point. Some of the organizations, these military organizations, are very similar to the RPF, the way they operate. They make attacks, they hold press conferences, and then they get all the media there. It's like, in other words, how many of you've heard held press conferences, how often you're able to get the media because you want to denounce what the Americans are doing. These guys can make attacks, they get all the media there, they get the George Clooney's, the Mia Farrow's over there, I'm serious, and it becomes a case. And in fact, it's a way of just, one of the things, it's a way of diverting attention from other issues, and particularly the Palestinian issue.
I would like to ask a final question, if there is no other question to be asked. But before I do that, I want to also add to what our guest has said tonight, and what you have raised in your questions, that there are many, many issues that complicate the conversation that we're having tonight about Africa. Africa and Africans do have agency, and in fact they play a role in what's going on there. So the Nile River plays, it's very central to part of the conflict that is going on, the water wars that many people have spoken about and are expecting to start happening. Middle East, North Africa, and its definition as a Middle Eastern region plays a very important role in, you know, all of this. As a matter of fact, most Africans would like to see Southern Sudan secede from the north. So it's really very complicated, and it's not much different from what is beginning to happen here in America. The corporatization of America is going to be leading to very similar complications in the near future. My final question is, if you could comment on that, what I just said, but also to finish up by, you know, commenting on the condition in Rwanda of today. What is the political environment like in Rwanda?
Well, it's a dictatorship. Victoire Ingabire went to go back there, and she first thing she did, she went back there and ran for president. Well, she's in prison. She's locked up. The first thing she did is she went to the genocide memorial and basically kissed the Blarney Stone and said, you know, this is what happened, and we went along with it. But she said, we're not in favor of this government. She's arrested. She's in prison. Peter Erlander was a lawyer for her. He was locked up. Peter Erlander's American lawyer was locked up. It's a dictatorship. Students in every university now, there are agents of the RPF in every university. So it's a clear dictatorship. And there's any number of former members of the regime who are exiled all over the world, South Africa, Europe, North America, Canada, in Quebec. There are all kinds of them, and they have stories to tell. So they are telling their stories. So it is. And the other thing is, everybody talks about this miracle. This is one of Gurevich's favorite things, and of course Bill Clinton's and Blair. The miracle. It's just crap. Just crap. There's a very good professor named Emmanuel Akizimana who wrote a very good article with a professor from the University of Chicago. Emmanuel is up in Montreal. And they analyzed the impoverishment of the peasant population. In other words, Kigali can look wealthy now because there's a lot of investment, there's a lot of money being coming through from Goma. But the population is much lower. The average annual wealth of the population of Rwanda has dropped enormously, and in other words, people are not eating enough. There's a high rate of poverty and a famine as well in the countryside, and of course the Hutu population is all basically peasants and live in the country, and they are agriculturally employed, and there's no investment for that. They redirected money into what they called the people who have made it through, the survivors of the genocide. Of course, that has been a way to redirect money to a certain section of the population and not to the Hutu majority, which is 80% of the population, 85% of the population still. So, and that part of the population has, his standard of living has dropped enormously since pre-1994. So the story about the Rwandan miracle is about many other stories of miracles that the World Bank and the United States will talk about. It's just not a miracle at all.
Thank you very much.
I just want to say that Phil Taylor, I really apologize. Go on his website. He interviews people from Africa regularly. He has some great interviews from Somalia and people, John Laughlin and others. It's taylorreport.com. My book is on that. But if you want to follow Africa, his radio program, you can listen to back programs, files and documents that are on it. So it's really, I highly recommend it.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Can we please give a...
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You mentioned Israelis' relationship to Darfur. Could you mention the United States' relationship to Israel? Because Chomsky says that it's the U.S. dictating to Israel. Other people say, no, it's not that way.
Well, I would tend to agree with Noam Chomsky on that. But I think that they're willing agents, which is the case of Rwanda. They're willing, very willing agents, and they have their own interests, but they definitely have their own interests, but they do not wag the dog. They're not the tail that wags the dog, you know. They are, in other words, the power is here, it's not there.
Thank you very much, both of you.
Thank you.